Is faith really irrational? And if taken to its logical end, does it inevitably lead to war and terrorism? Sam Harris, author of End of Faith, and Hugh Hewitt, who's a nationally syndicated radio host and author of If It's Not Close, They Can't Cheat, have very different opinions on religion, terror, and the future of reason. Sam, let me begin with you. Let me just see if I can correctly summarize the premise of your book. You say that faith in God is inherently irrational, and it results in conflict and war, and in this day of weapons of mass destruction, religious faith should no longer be tolerated by reasonable people. Is that a fair summary?
Yeah, that's a very good start, actually.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. So if I accuse you of religious intolerance, you would take that as a compliment.
Yeah, I'm arguing for a certain kind of intolerance. There's no way around that. But it's not the kind of intolerance that gave us the gulag or that would put people in prison for their religious beliefs. I'm arguing for just new rules of conversation. We can call it conversational intolerance, where, you know, if I came on your show and said the Holocaust never happened, I would immediately feel pressure from you to justify that claim, or you would marginalize me immediately as someone who just could not be trusted, at least on European history. But if I come on your show and say that I'm in dialogue with the creator of the universe, or if I know a cracker literally becomes the body of Jesus if you say the right Latin words over it, you have to give me a pass. It's taboo to criticize that, and that's really what I'm challenging in my book.
And so there is no God in your viewpoint?
Well, there's not sufficient evidence for, certainly not for a personal God, and certainly there's no evidence that he wrote any of our books. And we have to realize that we are in a situation where people are flying planes into our buildings because they think God wrote their book and that they're going to get to paradise by dying in the right circumstances. And it seems to me a point of really exquisite obviousness that the response to this situation cannot be, sorry guys, God wrote our book and you're going to hell for your actions.
Okay. Hugh, you must be one of the irrational ones because you are a Christian, as I understand it.
What's your
assessment of Sam's case?
Well, I read Sam's book closely. It's very well written, very provocative, but it's poorly grounded in history, in the theory of science, and in the theory of theology. He does not simply deal with most of the evidence that runs counter to his case. As a law professor, I'm obliged to say at that point, when you will not deal with the evidence that runs counter to your case, or you distort the evidence that is counter to your case, you wonder what's at the heart of the book. There's a problem out there. It's called violence and cruelty by men towards men, by men towards all sorts of people in the name of faith or in the name of rationalism. It's not about whether or not there's a God, it's about fanatics. And I think Sam has misdiagnosed the cause of fanaticism and has inappropriately laid it at the feet of people who believe, as I do, in a living God and in his word as revealed.
Okay, Sam, that's a strong critique.
Yeah.
I'll let you respond.
The idea that we somehow get our morality out of Scripture and that we would be at sea without the belief that our books were written by God really is unsubstantiated. And I agree with Hugh that the problem is human cruelty. But the problem of unjustified belief, religious faith, is that it justifies certain forms of cruelty in certain circumstances, and millions of people are motivated by the content of those beliefs.
Okay, let's let Hugh respond.
Some religious beliefs do justify cruelty. My faith does not. My faith does not allow for individual violence except in the case of just war under the organization of an appropriately ordained state. And I think that's generally the idea of Christianity in North America in the 21st century. What Sam's talking about, and you simply can't erase the 20th century, Sam, that Soviet-style communism was irrational in some respects, absolutely true. That Hitlerism was irrational in some respects, absolutely true. But they were both the products of systems that were thought to be scientifically rational, still defended to this day, by the way, by many people on the left and who are vigorous in simply saying they went bad because Mao was bad or Stalin went bad. No, they didn't. They went bad because men are bad. And there's a reason why men are bad, and that is the free will theory that we find in Scripture that you dismiss out of hand.
One thing is true. There are many very smart people over the ages who have believed in God, and I think this is a sociological problem because it just so happens that we have never forced people to really develop rational alternatives to discussing ethical intuitions and spiritual experience. I don't deny the validity of spiritual experience, and I don't deny the ideal of somebody like Jesus, at least as he appears in the Sermon on the Mount. What I do deny is that we have to believe anything on insufficient evidence to explore that range of human experience. But he has to explain, if religion is really not the issue, why don't we have Palestinian Christian suicide bombers, because this is practically a science experiment. You have the same people in the same oppressive conditions with the same language and the same culture, and yet one group makes, say, a sacrament of this kind of violence and
okay.
one doesn't.
Let's get Hugh's response. You?
Well, again, it's the wrong question, Sam. You've got to ask, why is there evil in the world? You always begin with the problem of evil. It's because men commit evil. Why are they so bad? It's because they are vain, they sin, they're separated from God, and they do not choose to conform their lives to the easily followed commands. But what I object to in your book, the thing that really disturbed me the most about it, is contrary evidence. Now, there are fanatics, there are even fanatics within Christendom, but there are many, many fanatics within this Islamist offshoot, Wahhabism, that is, you're mistaking for the disease, which is widespread. It's a bad problem.
Okay, let's get Sam's
nukes.
Well, it's true that Christians are playing their game very differently now in the 21st century, for the most part. That doesn't mean that there are not problems with Christianity, but the thing to credit for that development is not Christianity itself or the Bible. We have to credit hundreds of years of secular dialogue and scientific insights that have forced us to ignore certain aspects of our scripture, because the Inquisition.
Sam, I don't think that's why Mother Teresa went to the streets of Calcutta.
Well, but
not because
you have
of
to explain the Inquisition.
Discourse.
If you think that the people who were killing heretics for 500 years in Europe had not read the Sermon on the Mount, you're sorely mistaken.
Okay. We're going to come back in just a few moments, and when we do, we're going to find out how far would Sam go to purge religion from the world. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Sam, in your book, The End of Faith, you say some propositions are so dangerous that it may even be ethical to kill people for believing them. Certain beliefs place their adherents beyond the reach of every peaceful means of persuasion. Now, does that mean you would try to eliminate the violence associated with faith by using violence against people of faith?
Well, first, let me concede, it sounds like an extreme statement taken out of context. What I was arguing...
I just want your context.
Yeah. The context is, I'm arguing that beliefs are really not as private as we imagine they are. Beliefs have inevitable consequences. Insofar as you really believe something, whenever your behavior is implied in that belief, it's going to be affected by the beliefs. But we are dealing with some subset of the Muslim world that believes in principles of jihad and martyrdom, which are really deal breakers when it comes time to organize a global civilization. There's no possible future in which aspiring martyrs are going to make good neighbors. And until Muslims themselves start to acknowledge that and start to marginalize this death cult that is growing in their midst, we have a tremendous problem.
Okay, Hugh, is that fair?
Well, no, it's not. Sam is retreating from his book, and that's why I read it carefully. Sam's book is an invitation to religious oppression. It's an invitation to intolerance. It's an invitation to cruelty that it itself condemns. It's said that religion is, in the United States today, isolated from criticism. Far from it. Faith is becoming much beleaguered, much persecuted, much marginalized.
Right. Well, Hugh, no place in my book do I advocate religious persecution or jailing people for their beliefs. All I'm arguing for are new rules of conversation. I mean, we do not jail people for being stupid.
Well, Sam, when you write on page 93 that faith is the mother of hatred, or that anti-Semitism is part and parcel of Christianity and has to be, even in its modern variation, modern development, I think that induces hatred of Christians. I think that induces intolerance of people of faith. And I think it's dangerous.
Well, in that context, it calls Christians out for the irreducible sectarianism of their core beliefs. If you think that everyone is going to go to hell unless they call God by the right name or take Jesus as their savior, it is logically impossible to respect the beliefs of unbelievers. You know that those beliefs have stoked the very fires of hell.
You also make the statement that religious moderates are part of the problem, not part of the solution.
Right.
Seems counterintuitive. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's the moderate in our culture that is preventing a certain kind of conversation and preventing us from opposing the irrationality and dogmatism of real fundamentalists, people who take their scripture literally to be so, and in the Muslim world are inspired currently to practice tremendous violence.
Okay, Hugh, do you see moderates as being the problem or part of the solution?
But of course not. Again, this is part and parcel of the sort of rhetorical jihad that Sam has launched in his book against anyone who believes in faith. I believe reformations of faith are important, and they need to be linked with reformations of government. Human liberty is the natural law. It's God's gift. Jefferson had it right. And God did not intend for us to use that liberty to harm other individuals. Sam, for example, in his book, talks about the God of the Old Testament and how he is a really perverse and awful God and how people ought to be repelled by him. And it does not look forward to the reformation of what happened under the person of Jesus Christ and how people are called not to impose their beliefs on others, but to love them as the highest commandment.
Well, so Hugh, that's a selective reading of the New Testament. You can go into the New Testament and find in Matthew 5:17-18, you can find Jesus saying that every jot and tittle of the law has to be fulfilled. You can go into Romans and find Paul saying that homosexuals deserve to die. So you can play it either way, and this is the kind of game that I think we have to grow beyond, because the madman can find justification for his beliefs in any of our scriptures, certainly almost any of them, and conspicuously the Bible and the Quran. And until we get beyond this dogma that it's okay to believe that God wrote certain of our books, we are going to be balkanized into these separate moral communities with Muslims pitted against Jews, pitted against Christians.
Sam.
And no one had to be killed. I just want to
tell you one thing, Sam.
10 seconds.
You're not that smart. You're not that original. People have been down this road before. Okay. The reason God continues to involve himself in people's lives, despite the best effort of utopians, is because he's real, he affects them, and he has directed their lives if they'll just look at it.
We're out of time. Sam Harris, Hugh Hewitt, thank you so much.
Thank you.